Hello, malty milkmaids of Monrovia. I'm Ralphie, this is Whiskey Review 629, and thank you to Hugh Evans. No, Evan Hughes. Easy mistake to make. For the malt mention. Whiskey, single malt. Good start. Let's continue. Ledaig, also pronounced Ledaig. It depends which part of Scotland you're from or what mood you're in. But this is essentially peated Tobermory. This particular bottling in its nice little wooden container with its guillotine lid is the 1996 vintage, bottled in 2015, which makes it 19 years old. It is bottled at 46.3% volume. It is unchill filtered, and in my opinion, it's naturally coloured. It has a certain slightly apricot note to it, which I tend to find from experience relates to sherry casks, which have been toasted. And in fact, it's confirmed on the label here that this has been matured in Oloroso sherry casks. This is a peated whiskey, a distinctly peated whiskey, not lightly peated, but distinctly peated whiskey. And you will first come across Ledaig or Ledaig, depending on how you want to pronounce it, as a 10-year-old at 46%+ volume, a really good alternative to your Islay single malts. And if I say so myself, really quite consistent from batch to batch, which a number of Islay single malts are not. So far, so good. As a 19-year-old whiskey, I poured a glass of this about 15 minutes ago. I've added 3 teaspoonfuls of water to help it open up. And it's just settling down now. Just kind of taking its time. There's no rush, you see, malt mates. No rush. While this is opening up, I've probably poured myself, if I was doing my research, another little glass of single malt whiskey, maybe a blend, maybe a Lowlander or something from Speyside, which is not peated, but fairly approachable, accessible, amenable. Glenfiddich, good example. And I'm basically wetting my whistle or just getting my palate in tune for this more heavily peated experience. And what I've found so far is that it doesn't start out too promising. It is, in fact, particularly without water added, it's actually quite harsh. It's quite phenolically and slightly fusile peat. So particularly if you're a peat whiskey fan, we all like the big phenolic blast, but we don't like it when it's too slightly sulfury, too minerally, too harsh, too biting, too astringent, too tannic, and basically too immature. But first encounter with this particular whiskey can be quite misleading. If you've had the 10-year-old or even the 18, the standard 18-year-old, both of which are good whiskies, you might think, well, I'm ready to go on to this more obscure version. And your initial contact is saying, it's recognisable, but it's a bit unsettled. It's a little bit angry. It's a little bit rough. But this is where patience is so important. And I'm kind of mentioning this several times now over recent vlogs because it really is so important, for particularly for those who do not add water to whiskey. In that case, you want to leave it lying even longer just to oxidise slightly in the glass and really to what's called opening up. What does opening up mean? It means the fact that the spirit needs to aerate, rather like a wine, to basically smooth out the rough edges and to actually deliver its content in the most satisfactory manner to smell and taste. So this is not a whiskey you're going to rush into. Also of worth of note, for a 19-year-old single malt official bottling at a higher strength to cost less than £100 in the UK, is something of a minor miracle, and as such, you will find that Ledaig is a bit like some of the Speyside more heavily peated whiskies, because it's not got the reputation of the Islay malts and the expectations that of that people have of Islay malts, that it's not quite as expensive. And it's well worth exploring. Well, I'm exploring it. I'm recommending it because I'm reviewing it. Nose. Fresh peat. We're not talking old, mellow, toned down peat. For 19-year-old, the peat's pretty fresh in this. It's twiggy peat, slightly kulila, ashy, very tinderish, quite spent matches note to it, that sulphur note. It's not coming so much from the cask, a little bit from the cask, but it's coming from the peatiness and the spirit. And it's not unpleasant because it just happens to suit the character of this malt. Raisins, toffee, mint, quite a lot of mintiness in there. You often get mintiness with peated whiskies, but because you're so overwhelmed by the peat notes, you don't generally spot it. Good example of that is Ardmore. Now, having given it 18, 19 minutes in the glass, it's kind of becoming more aromatic. There's a bit more floral notes appearing and spiciness in the nose. It's most certainly opening up, and in doing so, you're getting quite chimney smoke. So you're getting almost a coal tar derived smokiness. Think coal tar, carbolic, definitely. Iodine? No, that tends to be more Lafroig. We're further north here. We're heading up towards Skye. This is somewhere between Islay and Talisker, Islay Distilleries and Talisker. But it's got its own particular nature, which defines its geographical position of being on the Isle of Mull. One distillery also produces Tobermory. It's Tobermory Distillery. This non-peated version is Tobermory. But once you taste this, you start to kind of get your bearings about different flavours from different places. And a good way of regionalising it is West Coast. You will often hear people that are right into their Scotch whisky talk about the West Coast character as being different from the East Coast character. The West Coast character being a lot more full-flavoured, a bit more two-dimensional in the finish, perhaps lacking less refined quality, but may compensating for it in sheer character. Which is just something you find in the likes of Springbank's, a West Coast distillery, and so is Ben Nevis and the new, recently built Ardnamurchan distillery. Well worth watching that one. Taste. What are we going to taste from this? Nip. Even after 19 minutes, still a real fresh, zippy sharpness. Almost a vinegar, cider vinegar citrus note, and a slight hot ginger. It's slightly rapidly produced spirit. And just briefly in that point, before I forget, since Byrne Stewart, the current owners of the distillery, took over, whoever's taken over that company. Whiskey companies change hands all the time, unfortunately. It's hard to keep up. The roughness that you used to get in old Ledaigs in particular, which made them unappealing. Whatever they've done, they've slowed down the stills and they've done other features in that distillery in terms of production, that since the mid-2000s, the new versions of Ledaig are noticeably better and more characterful than the 1990s versions from previous owners. I think that's quite significant, because one of the best places to experience Ledaig is from the independent bottlers, particularly young versions. They will give you the huge slap in the face phenolic blast that you can no longer afford from Ardbeg and Lafroig. Never go on your first impressions. Your palate needs to get used to the experience and the sensation before you make judgments. That's why we often ignore the first couple of tastes of a whiskey, particularly when we first encounter it. But now, I'll just go over this again. Tastes more like a 12-year-old whiskey than a 19. But there's some really slightly leathery sherry cask in the background, which is starting to creep in a sweetness, which is balancing off that sharp, dry, tangy, slightly hot, fusile phenolic note with all that ashiness. It's like you've had a wood fire and then you've put some coals on it and then you've left it overnight and you come back in the morning and you have a quick sniff around the embers. You're getting that. Also, there's a pine note, a conifer note in this, that slightly sharp, tangy juniper aspect that you get, particularly when you have a fire of pine cones and juniper branches, which generally make very good kindling. Malt mark. If you're a peated whiskey fan, you'll enjoy this. If you're not a peated fan, pass it by, malt mates. You'd be wasting your money. 96 out of 100, that is a malt mark from a 19-year-old single malt heavily peated Scotch whiskey matured in ex-sherry casks. What more would add to this? It's the best presentation it really can be, being bottled over 40% nunchal filtered, and you're gradually seeing, and sounding quite slowly, a little bit of Scotch mist in the glass. Frankly, there should be more, in my opinion, particularly from peated whiskies, which tend to come from squat pot stills. Therefore, the actual the way of squat pot stills is that more vegetal barley oils will get pulled over into the line arm, into the condenser, and into the final new mix spirit than you would get with tall necked stills like Bruichladdy or Glenmorangie in particular. So I wouldn't expect tall necked stills to generate as much Scotch mist as I would squat pots. These are little tubby, chubby stills, the likes of which are used at Tobermory. Now we're really seeing the sweetness of the cask assert itself with more raisins, a little bit of treacled notes in the background, but it's still, at 19 years old, it's an experience below its age. And I don't mean that as a critical judgment. I mean that as an objective point of reference. Okie dokie, malt mates, what else can I add to this review? What can I mention that I've not mentioned before that you may find interesting, unless you're just here for the malt mark, at which point you're just going to stop viewing? Well, stay viewing, malt mates, because I'd like to explore why Isla is so reputation bound to heavily peated whiskies. And there's a few observations I'd like to make. The first of which is Isla also makes unpeated whiskies, which are of actually very good quality, and obvious examples are Bruichladdy 10-year-old, which I've recently reviewed, which is a superb complex, dense whiskey. And another good example is Bunahabhain. Bunahabhain is a 12-year-old, is essentially an unpeated whiskey, and it delivers a really good quality, available and affordable single malt experience. The rest of Isla's distilleries tend to be associated with heavy peatedness. Kilhoman, good example. One of Islay's youngest distilleries, but not for long. You've got the triple whammy of Lagavulin, Ardbeg, and Lefroig. They're the obvious examples when you talk about big, smoky, peaty, characterful experiences, and they're all very close to one another, literally within a few miles on the same coastline, and that is not coincidental. You're really looking at a provenance hotspot in that particular coastline of Islay. Other distilleries, you've got Colilla, which fortunately tends to be one of the most affordable, available quality single malt experiences if you have availability to independent bottlers and you're careful what you buy. And you've got Bowmore. Bowmore, it's overbranded in my opinion, frankly. There's too much goes into the packaging and the marketing and the chill filtration and the colouring. And we know damn well it can produce great whiskey, but I find myself, when I'm now looking for Bowmores, I'm looking at independent bottlers almost exclusively. I'm now at the stage I'm bypassing official bottlings, simply because where I am as an independent reviewer that's not looking for samples is that I really want to buy the best that I can for the money I've got, just like you're doing with your budgets. So you have this reputation on Islay. It's not a lot of trees in Islay. It's one of the most low-lying islands on the west coast. It gets the full force of Atlantic blasts, and it happens to be covered predominantly by peat bogs, and peat has been for thousands upon thousands of years the traditional fuel, in fact the only fuel available to the Eilach, or the folk from Islay. Certainly there are other distilleries who have produced peated whiskies very successfully in the past, and a classic example is Brora. It's been stunningly good, but it's not alone. There have been others which have produced peated versions, and funnily enough, I believe it's St Magdalen in Lithgow at one point was producing some quite heavily peated whiskey simply as an ingredient option, a flavour option to the blend market, the blended whiskey market which was utterly dominant 100 years ago, right up until about 20 years ago actually. But you've also got Ardmore on a good day, and it needs a good day, and honestly I do think Ardmore just doesn't get the casks that it deserves for proper maturation. Official bottlings, it is a good original quality peated experience, as our Benromach Peat Smoke is a fantastic peated whiskey from essentially which is the Highland. It's a Highland whiskey. I wouldn't call Benromach a Speyside whiskey. It's a Highland coastal distillery. Not that far from Brora, really. But apart from that, you've got Talisker, you've got Highland Park, both are great peated whiskies in their own right. So it's not just about Islay. And I would suggest that as we're now in the age of world whisky, you know, your global whisky scene, where you have some very good French peated whiskies, some decent quality Irish, well, one decent quality Irish peated whiskey, and a few American peated whiskies, still rather young. And again, this is still a criticism that's being levelled at the small craft distillers, you know, selling their spirit at a very young age. You're getting the big peat blast, fair enough, but it's a bit of a two-dimensional experience, but it's good. The quality is out there. What would be interesting, of course, is by far best the best place in the world that peated whisky is not made and yet's got plenty of peat bogs is New Zealand. Will we see peated whisky from New Zealand one day? Yes, we will. We will. I can assure you of that. And various other places that you would not expect. Did I mention Amrut from Bangalore in India? And they're good quality peated versions. There's peat bogs in India. Yes, there is. Up in the foothills of the Himalayas. Himalayas, you see, a big thing about peat is it is very slow decomposing. I was actually about to blend a word, decompositing. Decomposing deposit, another word merger, of mainly highly acidic plant decay. In a covers are about roughly about 11% of the planet's surface. There's a lot of peat bogs out there. They're not going to disappear tomorrow night. That's not going to happen. Some of them are hundreds of feet deep because they've been building up. A foot of peat bog takes 1,000 years to grow. There's that little vegetation in the surface, and it decays that slowly in that acidic environment. And the acidity, it pickles the vegetal decay. And that is why you have such a presence of phenols from peat. There you go. Now, you know, just sharing. I don't want to get too deep into it, but I hope you've enjoyed this whiskey review. Just sharing a little bit more without getting too scientific and analytical about it. I've got to keep it kind of fairly sip-sized and manageable. I'm Ralphie. Thank you for watching this review. If you hop on back again for another moment for Whiskey Review 630, I'll be reviewing, let me see now, I'll be reviewing an old grain whiskey. Grain whiskies, because there's a bit of a buzz about grain whiskies from Scotland, and I think there's things you need to know, malt mates, to understand what you're dealing with here. And I'm going to share that with you next time round. Have you enjoyed yourself? Well, I hope so, because do you know what, malt mates? I have. See you soon.